In an earlier video, we took a look at these settings for the PiPoint data references, but only in as much as we needed to specify the tag names and the unit of measures, and I said we would come back to that. So now's the time to take a look at these different retrieval methods, and let's start with the most common types of retrievals. Now that would be the retrievals in which you're interested in some kind of an aggregation, like an average. Let me demonstrate. I'm going to demonstrate this using a Let's look at a pie tag that's got fairly regular behavior. This is a tag called sinusoid. As you can see, it's a tag that takes a value from 0 to 100. And if we were to take a look at this over the period of 24 hours or so, you'll notice every 12 hours it goes from 0 to 100. So it has an average roughly every 12 hours. Just about any 12 hours you look at it, it's going to be around 50. And also, if you look at this, I've got the markers turned on here so that we can see the actual values. It's not generating a lot of data, so it's only going to be generating about, I think it's about 40 values every 2 days, something like that, maybe 25 values a day. So it's a good option for us to use so that we can kind of tell, you know, what we're looking at. We know what the average should be. We know about what the count should be. So and what I'm looking at right here is this is the actual pie tag, sinusoid. Now this, on the other hand, is an AF data reference. It's a data reference to this AF element called mixing tank 2. We're looking at the pressure attribute. And the reason we have sinusoid and this on the same screen is because, in fact, that attribute is pointing to the tag sinusoid. So the changes that we see over here are going to reflect essentially what's going on with sinusoid. And that's what we're seeing right here. The value here is 73.5. It's coming up here as 73.4996. Anyway, as you can see, that's, we're looking at essentially the same value here, both in the actual pie tag and in the AF attribute that points to it. Well, so far so good. That would be expected. Now let's say I'm interested in producing I think we'll look first at a series of about 12-hour counts. We want to see how many values we're getting every 12 hours. It's kind of an unusual calculation. Normally people do things like totals or averages, but we're just going to do a count because it's a little easier to work with. Well, in order to do that, what I would choose is I would specify time range for my retrieval method by time, and for my relative time, I'm going to specify asterisk minus 12 hours, or I can just use minus 12 hours. Now, as far as the actual calculation, that's set once you've specified time range. In this by time range, you specify what it is you're interested in. So I could specify a total or an average. In this case, I'm interested in a count. Now, this last field by case is something that is not supported at this point. It will not be supported until we support event frames within AF. And right now, that's not supported, so you can ignore this. Now there's only one last thing I do need to consider, and that is whether this is a time-weighted or an event-weighted calculation. If it's a time-weighted calculation, the way we actually do that with something like count, we would just count the number of seconds in that 12-hour period, kind of a meaningless calculation. When we do averages, we count the values, interpolate values once a second, and then divide by the number of seconds. So count produces that kind of an unusual time-weighted count. But if I'd simply specify this as event-weighted, what you'll see is it's going to return the number of events. And it's telling me it's got 9 events in the last 12 hours, which just about matches what we see here. This is only 8 hours we're looking at here, but that's about 9 events. Just a minor point here. Look at what happens when you do event-weighted, or time-weighted, excuse me. Yeah, that's returning the number of seconds in 12 hours, 43,200. So, and it returns it that way because of the way we do a time-weighted average. Essentially, a time-weighted average is an interpolated value for each second. Add all those up, divide by the number of seconds. So when we're using count, that's why we get that number. Anyway, that's a bit of a digression. The point is, what I've specified is that we've got this. We're doing a calculation that's now by time range, and that's the time range. And in this case, the calculation is count. I could have just as easily chosen average. The 12-hour average for sinusoid should be around 50, and as you can see, that's what it is. Here's my tag pressure. That's the 12-hour average. The 12-hour count, is around 9. Now let's take a look at how this affects the process book trend. Before I can actually see that in process book, though, I do need to check this in. I'll go ahead and check it in. We'll go out here, and as you can see, this is now showing me this count of 9. So for that 12-hour period, that's what we see. Now, did you notice that that just changed from 9 to 7? What happened? Did we just lose two values? Actually, no. It's an interesting artifact of the design. What we're looking at here is we're looking at something that's a calculation that pays attention to the time context. So the time context is actually being passed over to AF, and we're returning the value given the current time context. And the time context here is 8 hours. So for example, if I go out to, let's go with 1.3 days, watch what happens over here. We've got 23 values. If I go out further, we'll see more and more values. And that's because, as I said, the context is being passed over to AF, and the calculation is being retrieved given that context. It's a nice feature that when we support event frames, it'll be a lot very, very useful for batch-oriented retrieval. So by passing time context or supporting time context, we'll have a nice mechanism for showing things on an event by event basis. So and if I go ahead and switch this back, there we go. Now we're back to I've restored the defaults, and then when this updates, and this is updating every 15 seconds. Yeah, there we go. Back to 8 hours. Yeah, so this is going back to the saved version when I revert. That's why we keep coming back to 9. And then within 15 seconds, this will update with the current context. So as you can see, it's very active, proactive, I guess you'd say. It's using the time context that it picks up from process book. That's something that can be changed by using this option here called time range override. By time range override, what we're specifying here is that, and let me go ahead and check this in, what we're specifying is that we would like to override whatever the local context settings are. So in this case, now, if I were to go back, look at a couple of days, no problem. Since I've set this to time range override, that time range override on the AF side is going to override whatever local context we have. Okay. And there's one other thing that we can do with this that I'd like to demonstrate. And that is, we do support doing a kind of a time offset. Well, actually, before we look at that, let's look at a more useful thing than count. A more useful than count, of course, would be to look at something like average. So if I specify average, again, watch what happens if I just choose time range. And I'm choosing average. Let's make this, in this case, let's make this time-weighted. People are generally interested in time-weighted. And I think what I'll do here is let's go with 4 hours. We're using 4 hours because, of course, the 12-hour average of sinusoid is always going to be 50, no matter what time of day you look at it, because it is that has that 12-hour period from 0 to 100. So now that I've set this to be a 4-hour average, using my relative time here, then this is coming back as 89. And if I were to take a look over here, let me check it in. Always make sure you check this in if you want to see the effect over here. And we're seeing that's coming back as 89. But watch what happens as I start to scroll back in time. As I scroll back in time, again, because I'm using the time range without the time range override, this is doing the calculation for us going back each time, producing a 4-hour average with the end time as the end point of this average. Watch as we move backward in time, that timestamp right here, 111, it's picking that up from the end time here.